Henry Dundas was a powerful politician. He was Lord Advocate, in charge of war, he was in charge of the Navy, he was in charge of the Board of Control, he in fact was Keeper of the Signet, he was Governor of the Bank of Scotland. That's how powerful he was. And I'm standing in St. Andrew's Square in Edinburgh. We're here today to discuss Henry Dundas, the first Viscount Melville. And his statue is right behind me. And in fact, I'm told it's 150 feet high. Now, one may be considering why anyone has got a statue so high in the middle of Edinburgh. In fact, people ask me that all the time. I can't give them an answer.
Years after he died, Henry Dundas still stands on his looming pedestal in Edinburgh. For decades, he was the most powerful figure in Scotland. He served as Home Secretary, extended British power in India, and notoriously delayed the abolition of the slave trade for 15 years. At the weekend, his plinth was daubed with graffiti, as was a street bearing his name.
One of his other great acts, for which he is remembered, is that he was very interested in slavery. And his interest in slavery was that he regarded it as important for the stability and the economic benefits of Great Britain. He defended that position by stopping William Wilberforce from abolishing the slave trade for 15 years. He did it in the House of Commons, and he did it by negating the value of abolition. And he did it by putting into the act one powerful word, and that powerful word was that slavery should be gradually abolished. And in order for Wilberforce to get the act through to abolish the slave trade, he had to accept Dundas's word of gradual abolition.
Henry Dundas, as Home Secretary, was the man who delayed the abolition of the slave trade by 15 long years. Michael Fry is a columnist and Dundas biographer.
He judged the right and wise thing to do was just to damp down the whole business so that nobody got too excited about it. That was his purpose, because there was no point in having an economy which had previously been based on slavery collapse. That would have served nobody's interest at all.
Personally, I believe that he did it gradually to make sure that there was no rebellions or uprisings or any to make a smoother transition as possible.
reason why some people are misguidedly attacking him is because they claim to delay the abolition of slavery for 15 years. Well, that's one way of looking at it, but you could just as easily look at it and say that he speeded it up. He hastened it.
I am Sir Banastra Tarleton, Member of Parliament for Liverpool. I fear that our empire will not survive without the slave trade. I shall do my utmost to thwart Mr. Wilberforce's misguided schemes.
The present Viscount Melville actually stated that his ancestor was actually an abolitionist. When I saw that, I was not only disturbed by it, I was annoyed by it because it's just nonsense. In fact, it's insulting. It's insulting to abolitionists like Wilberforce, and it's also insulting to history. Because this is a man who actually stopped the abolition of the slave trade for 15 years.
In 1792, Dundas stated in Parliament that the slave trade ought to be abolished. I have already declared.
In 1778, we had a case in Scotland where a slave master brought back one of his slaves with him from Jamaica. The slave ran away, and the slave master, of course, wanting his slave back, took the matter to court. And the right of the slave to be free in Scotland was defended by Henry Dundas, the first Viscount Melville.
Stood for night and made the case for night. and it was this 1778 case which established that slavery was illegal in Scotland. So ladies and gentlemen, slavery was established as illegal in Scotland by Henry Dundas, the man you are claiming was for slavery. So do you realise how wrong you've got that?
What the Scottish courts ruled was that the slave should be free in Scotland. Dundas was Lord Advocate at the time, and the ruling was based on the following, the law, that since there was no slavery in Scotland, you could not have a slave. Also, it's based on the rights of individuals in Scotland at the time, that if you did not tell someone that you want to be a slave or their slave, they couldn't enslave you. And that was how Joseph Knight was freed. Now, there's a precedent to this case in England, and that was in 1772, where Lord Mansfield freed the slave Somerset, and he freed him on the same basis. So all Henry Dundas and the Scottish judges were doing was to confirm a judgment which had previously occurred in England. Now, I cannot see how that makes Henry Dundas, the first Lord Melville, an abolitionist.